So today I'm going to detail my findings on Ankhrasmation, the musical language of composer and multi-instrumentalist Ishmael Wadada, who was born on December 18, 1949, and I worked with him closely during the time of this research. By a show of hands, just so I can get a better picture, how many of us know who he is, has heard his music? Okay. For those who haven't, this is a clip.
Our music is based off systems, and systems are not free.
So in a way, what Professor Smith does with Ankhrasmation, his musical language, is to try and create a system in which we are able to be free. This promise, this profound promise, is what brought me to his doorstep. I'm going to argue that Ankhrasmation is Professor Smith's response to what he considers to be a problematic distribution of agency in various spheres of society between the privileged and the disenfranchised, as well as in music between the composer and the performer. This is the microcosm of the social. This was my thesis last year when I was a graduate student at UCLA's Department of Ethnomusicology. My understanding of praxis comes from the fourth chapter of Pedagogy of the Oppressed, where Paulo Freire says of the term, human activity consists of action and reflection. It is praxis. It is transformation of the world. And as praxis, it's required. It required theory to eliminate it. Human activity is theory and practice. It is reflection and action. As such, Ankhrasmation is posited to be Professor Smith's form of praxis. And for those who attended the keynote performance yesterday, we know that Imani is praxis. After the 2 years of working with Professor Smith, now I know in the academy that we refer to our interlocutors, our informers and subjects formally with their last name, but I'm going to go ahead and say Professor Smith, because where I come from, we never call an elder by their name. And I don't know if this is being live streamed, but if my parents see me do that, I'll be in trouble. The final question that lingered in my mind after working with Professor Smith was a relationship between reflection and action. Now this question haunts me now even with more urgency given the current state of our political affairs. From yesterday, I gather many of us are wary of too much reflection because it can drain us and leave us paralyzed, unable to act. For the younger stratum of academics here today, including me, perhaps this is our first time in our lives that we are compelled to flood the streets in protest. But before we step out, do we reflect on how those actions will actually affect our causes? Is our relationship between action and reflection balanced? Despite having taught at various institutions, particularly for decades at CalArts, from where he recently got an honorary doctorate degree, Professor Smith is just not trusting of the academy. The academy's ability to reflect on action and reflection equally. In fact, I was thus warned thusly by him. Musicians find themselves to be on the ground floor. Now, academics probably roam on the first. They can look down on you. They have bridges that connect them to other floors, higher floors, but they probably don't want to come down and see yours. Most of them don't realize the ground floor is actually much, much larger than their buildings. You can't explain to them something that they haven't seen. Now, if you try too hard, they might make it harder for you. And we just don't want that. This statement, his wise but resigned voice, reminds me of Plato's Republic, in particular his allegory of the cave, where a group of people who had lived chained to the wall of the cave their entire lives, with all the shadows projected on it, objects passing in front of the fire. They give names to these shadows. These shadows are the prisoner's reality, but we learn how a philosopher is like a prisoner. It is freed from the cave and comes to understand that the shadows on the wall are not reality at all. I sense a general distrust in Professor Smith, not towards me, but rather towards the various institutions of power. So the question is, how do you keep pushing yourself out of the cave? Education? What happens when institutions use education as a means of keeping you chained in the cave? Is Professor Smith being paranoid? Or is it possible that our education is still inclined to favor the Eurocentric? I don't know, you tell me, Bach, Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, Chopin? Where is an Indian American whose immigrant parents didn't know much about American history or music? Where was I supposed to learn about the Valentine? Does anyone have a spoken? Now, Professor Smith had his own way of dealing with suppressive discipline. He self-released much of his work on his own Cabell records, which he owned and operated. The reasoning behind this becomes very clear when you read his manifesto, Notes, in which he calls for the conscious black man to take back his narrative by not allowing someone else to narrativize it. The observations he made then are still sadly relevant to today's world. If you haven't read it already, I would highly recommend it. In it, he urges us to consider isolation as a means of self-protection, especially for those familiar with hostile words. I surely have not experienced the flagrant dehumanizing lack of agency that Professor Smith must have witnessed in his lifetime. Professor Smith's philosophy treats the creation of art as a means of documentation. He was but 13 years of age when the United States was still segregated. Professor Smith possesses a personal archive of memories that can address much, much darker parts of our history. But more importantly, he has the ability to speak to the defense mechanisms that he has used to successfully combat this darkness. From Notes, we learned that one such mechanism that he employed was to, quote, not wait for others to document their distortions of what you can rightly say for yourself. One may assume that his socioeconomic structure as a young man of color in a newly post-segregated America predisposed him to a condition where the concept of self-value was presented to him with quite resistance. I am led to believe that this conflict was mostly an orchestration by those with privilege, from a place of insecurity, who believed that they would lose their own self-value if those below them in the socioeconomic structure were granted more rights, as if human rights is a finite thing with a finite source. If agency is defined as the capacity to act on one's intentions, then the struggle between the privileged and the less privileged is understood to be a fight over agency. The issue of distribution of agency is an important theme in Professor Smith's music. It is often the problematization to which he answers. Through Ankhrasmation, he pushes the musician to not only place themselves equal to the composer, but to see themselves as collaborators. Having experienced an unequal access to agency in life, he has no interest in imposing that on anyone else in any way, even in his music. Okay, so how does one do this? I'm indebted to Eric Porter's publication, What Is This Thing Called Jazz? For offering a uniquely useful and formal perspective, Professor Smith. Says Porter, the history of Ankhrasmation. Briefly, it was Professor Smith's interest in, quote, fusing the creative musical ideal with the most positive discoveries from classical music, as well as his interest in cross-cultural music exchanges. Which resonated in a parallel project of creating a symbolic language to organize and analyze improvisation. In an interview with Porter, Smith is believed to have said that he hoped the symbolic language would conjure up those kind of utopias like the ones that Martin Luther King built. One where you'll be able to connect to something of value when you live in a hostile environment. So So what is Ankhrasmation? The Ankh is a symbol found in ancient Egyptian hieroglyphics. He defines the Ankh to be a vital life energy or source. The Ankh, as it is, was found in early hieroglyphics as thought, among other things, to be the cross-section of a thoracic vertebrae of a bull, and this in turn symbolized life. Ras is the Arabic word for head. It's also on the head. As a nod to the anthropological universal, the final root is derived from the cross-culturally common term for mother, namely Ma. Thus, we have Ankhrasmation, a vital life force that is presumably a product of a universal father and mother, where everyone is equal. Eric Porter writes, quote, according to Smith, the component elements of Ankhrasmation reach back to Egyptian cultural and philosophical traditions, while its members of male and female elements of the family signified a connection with all the things the human can be. This is how Ankhrasmation looks. This is a musical tower panel on Ankhrasmation's axis. This particular score is called Serhana, which is one of his daughter's names. This is a picture taken at the band center, which is where I met Professor Smith. Also seated is Professor Ayer. Now, scholars insist that ethnographers bear the responsibility of situating themselves in their own work, so that when revisited, potential biases are more easily divorced as needed from their own ethnographic reporting. So I'm going to offer this. I consider Professor Smith a teacher of mine. My habitus includes training in various upbringing classical arts, and I see traces of the Buddhist Ishe conditioning in my relationship with him. That being said, it was arguably my willingness to be open with him and let myself be considered a student and not an equal that granted me a specific access into this creative process. The ethnographic process is simply inherently invasive. It creates a disjuncture between his presence as I experienced it otherwise and the statements he made when the discussion was geared towards the project. I later realized this is because he deeply distrusts any institutions of power. Acknowledging the difficulty of bridging the gap between the personal and the public, my presentation here tries to contribute towards the public sketching of a trumpet legend. I didn't actually make that up. That is how he's described as in California Institute of the Arts 2016 graduation brochure. That grants access this narrative in the afterthought of consideration. Here is my picture of Professor Smith as a teacher. Even those who did not work with him in the capacity of an official student still think of him as a teacher. Often, their favorite teacher. This is not to say that some did not express frustration at not understanding the material, because he will not give you straightforward instructions on how to pronounce translation. He instead supports autodidactism. He wants you to reach out and do your own research, because he doesn't want you to believe anything that you've been taught. Not much of it is taught, therefore, in a straightforward manner. Students are either nonplussed, enamored, or frustrated when they're first presented with this somewhat abstract and circuitous methodology. But this isn't to say that he's not open. Many students, including me, have visited his private residence in New Haven. And I've spoken to him at length, Carlos has as well, spoken to him at length about Ankhrasmation. He's really happy to work with anyone who's interested. Yet he has never published a publicly available document in which he would explain in detail how Ankhrasmation works. The images that I have here are actually from the only known public document which discussed the rules of Ankhrasmation. And in all my questions, he did not give them to me. He asked me to find them. It took me 1.5 years to find them. I finally found them with Professor Anthony Davis, who I think got his permission before he started to me. When I finally did tell him that I found it, he said, good, and nothing else. If you would like this document, though, I'm happy to share it with you after we have a conversation about the rules in which Professor Smith asked us to explain. But after this, I was led to theorize that autodidactism is an important feature in his teaching methodology. I believe that he sees instruction as a means of indoctrination, and therefore it becomes a means of discipline. And for this reason, Professor Smith has always carefully chosen how not to explicitly instruction in any manner. The most important thing or aspect of Ankhrasmation, in my experience, wasn't the commands that were featured in the previous slide, but instead this slide. It's called referencing. This is how one of these scores looked. It was one of the first scores that we saw when he was teaching to us. And I certainly cannot replicate his presence or his teaching methodology. But I can say that he spent a good 20 minutes interrogating us about it. Did we get a pointer here? That's okay, I think I can use the mouse. There we go. Is that good?
Yeah.
He asked us what the difference between this and this is, these two things, if you would compare them. Does anyone have any suggestions? They're inverse of each other. How so? So if you had to play that, would you be able to? Or speak that, express that in any form? Let that be the point of beginning a stream of consciousness. This is Ankhrasmation. He explained to us that his own personal interpretation of this was that the above was different from the below, and that the above represented an astral star because it was silver, and below it was golden, which you can't see very clearly here, but therefore it was a star that you can see, and therefore one is alive, one is not, one is an astral body, one is not, and it was so plainly obvious that you should play it. In the same way, he said, how would you play these different colors? What is the difference between playing the lower stratum and the higher stratum? He said that the lower was harder because this was so clearly an ocean, and that the light could not come down to the bottom. And then he explained how much research, or what he calls referencing, he had done to create this. In the process of creating this image, he understood how light refracted, he understood what kind of animals are in what sea levels, and he believes that when he's able to play now this image that he's created, it bears the entire weight of all of the information that he read. And when his music is being performed, it reflects all of that knowledge that he collected for himself. And that he needed no institution to do this, and that neither do you. In the spirit of honesty, I will say that the work was received in polar ways in my department at UCLA. The most common criticism was that it lacked critical distance, which very well may be true, as you can see. But I'm okay with that, because if I have to err, I'd rather err on the side being too considered when I'm representing someone else's narrative. Of course, there were also some other troubling issues in my defense where one professor did not know what the AACM was, but... I just like it. I will conclude very quickly to say that I believe Professor Smith's work to be accurate. Through the principles behind improvisation that we discussed in the panel today, he's able to posit behavioral and philosophical suggestions that may very well be useful to our society. Daniel Fishman writes in his work, the underlying message of the identity of communitarian outreach is loud and clear, with improvisation a fundamental expression of both establishing and paying homage to Black identity. Fishman uses the neologism improvocracy to discuss his work. When I was questioned by the department as to why I thought that Professor Smith's work was significant enough to warrant a thesis being written on it, my response was this. Professor Smith has directly experienced conditions that gave him greater insight into a darker part of American history. As I had said before, I will say again because I believe it so strongly, he has had to form defense mechanisms, effectively create strategies for helping the situations to make it less hostile and to combat this darkness, though he still faces it. His praxis and that of early creative music performers is truly worth studying for this reason.
Yeah.
Professor Smith's intention was not to necessarily tie it in that way, but to say that everyone has the right to interpret knowledge in any way that they feel so, and that art does not require any form of formal training, that everyone has the right, not just the right, but the responsibility to express. I believe that he expects all of us to draw from our own personal archives. He does not trust the collective archive, and I do not blame him. Given when he was born and what he has witnessed. As I had said in the beginning, I hesitated to submit anything to this conference Because I'm American, but I'm not black, and I did not wish to take up space that was meant for someone else. But after working with Professor Smith, my understanding of his unique form of grotesque and resistance, my conclusion is that it is our responsibility to express when we can express. What I say may not have an effect in this lifetime, but we must express in that the fear of being wrong is not enough to subdue that, but it's better to speak out and then be corrected. With regards to Black Lives Matter, specifically with my paper, Professor Smith does not necessarily associate himself with movements for the reasons that I had spoken to. So I didn't think it was appropriate for me to forcefully tie it, because perhaps it would not be relevant to his work, but I do strongly believe that his inclination to control your own narrative, to never backing down, to being unapologetic, these are things that I learned from him. But I do think that they're effective in combating whatever form of privilege.
Really quickly, I know I spoke yesterday, but I really do have to make it clear as an activist, as a black woman who is in this fight and in the reality and who is experiencing death, like I said yesterday in Baltimore, someone was shot in a radical bookstore that is run by my friends in the co-op who are resisting and being effective in Baltimore City. I really need next year, if this happens again, for this talk to truly tie in with the Black Lives Matters movement and the reality of the brutality. My next book is going to be called A Safe Way to Awaken to Brutality, because we're not getting there, and I need, thank you for the history. I'm yelling at my brothers, so we fight together, and we have the resistance in the Black Arts Movement that I really need everyone to understand that people are dying today through systemic hatred from the police and from governmental civilizations who are even bringing in fake activists to shoot people and to protest, to make us look like we are violent. That is how they resist in Baltimore. When we become more effective, they become violent. It doesn't work that way in Boston. Maybe gentrification is happening. In every city, there's something different going on. But in Black Lives Matters and music, and I hope, again, the panel will address, because I want to hear my brothers speak on this, because they are in it. I'm with them. I'm here because of them. And you guys did a great job. It's refreshing. But we're not talking about Black Lives Matter. So that's all I'm gonna say. Just please be reminded.
If you come last night to my keynote performance, I mean my new jury.
It came full.
Were you there last night?
You know, sister.
Hi, sister. Thank you for raising this issue. I'm starting to take over, but I did a keynote performance last night in Holden Chapel, and it was around the Hush Harbor, looking at the roots of spirituals as a coded form of protest and rebellion, sacred music embodying also protest and resistance and narratives of escape and rebellion. And so I definitely covered that and read the African-American spirituals through the lens of protest, Black Lives Matter. And also I didn't talk about how they connected and continued on in the civil rights era and on, but it has been addressed. Maybe not everyone who did to come, but that was the main point of my keynote performance, talking about this kind of foundational legacy of Black American music, or American music for that matter, which is the African American spiritual that specifically dealt with enslavement and strategies, sacred strategies, intellectual praxis around how to deal with the brutality of being a black body on this continent, in this country. So I just wanted to make sure that that was an agreement. We did talk about that.
A big fan, and I honestly, at the end of the last panel, a couple of the brothers and sisters didn't address healing, and I've had some radical sisters like, we don't know what to do, so I apologize for not coming, and I'd love to come over there and talk to you by the end of it, so I hear you, and thank you.
Thank you for raising it. It's important to make it real because we're at a conference, but this is real life. It's life and death, and a lot of the people who are most impacted by what's going on are not in this room. They're living it right now, and we're here in the privileged space to wax poetic.
We should give our panelists.
No, we are. I just wanted to make my statement. Sorry, Professor Munch.
Stand up, sister. Thank you. And there are no elders over 55. I haven't seen any. You just let your black on crack, okay? But there's one. Fine.
I was born in 1961.
All right.
Yeah, but I'm born in 1960.
Last night when I said that, nobody jumped up.
So I'm driven. I know I look good.
Black on crack.
But, definitely, I'm probably the eldest expert here. So I've lived all of the things that you're imagining. I lived them all coming from Birmingham in that segregated existence. I was just having seen whites going to blacks on the signs and having going through all that. Having seen little boys disappear as I was a young kid off into the woods somewhere and beaten senselessly. This has been a constant narrative, so it's nothing new to me. I mean, that's just my thing. It's just not. I'm glad everybody's sort of waking up and gotten up to speed a little bit, but this is something that has been manifesting for years and it's something that we have been talking about. And so I appreciate the urgency in which you sort of bring this to fruition in terms of talking about the black life. One thing I will say, and I made this kind of evident in my talk, is that we still, come back. It's like Audre Lorde said, man, if you're trying to dismantle the master's house with the master too, you have already, failed. You know what I'm saying? So you need to take the master tools out your toolbox.
I questioned why I was here.
Like the system right. Is built for, slides, but it's not built for reconfiguration. Right. So the system, if we're fighting, what are we fighting for in terms of that? For me, it's dismantling the system because the system has proven historically that it doesn't work.
I agree.
So anyway, I'm not going to take too much time. I didn't.
I just wanted to say really briefly. I guess I could have been more explicit. I thought I was trying to highlight a lot of the political aspects of the artists that I was looking at. Montana Roberts organized an event, a concert to raise money for Michael Brown's legal defense. Kamea Yewa has been. If you look at the liner notes in her record, it's a call to revolution. I think it literally says that.
I think her book release in Baltimore on February 25th.
I guess I didn't use the word split, I didn't use the tag Black Lives Matter explicitly, but I thought I was, in my paper, I was really trying to highlight, I think, what I see as radical revolutionary artists in this moment, who I think are expressing a lot of this through what they're doing.
You questioned the concept of having Black Lives Matter and music tied together, correct? And you don't see it being necessary, but taken in this environment or in 2000?
In this conference and the reality of the brutality of the fight and that it happens every single second of the day, and I think the last speaker was saying that we're not at an 11, it's not catastrophic. When I'm on the phone texting, sitting here, when someone is in critical condition, homicide's on it because he's that bad. So I had to stand up last night and say, we are at an 11, this is a reality. These are my best friends at Red Emmis. We've spoken at that space. And I was on the phone giving them self-care. If I take care of yourself, I gave my brother a few candles before we left and some stones too, because I knew, I felt something was going on. So the movement is constant. So I just, how do we, and you as a black artist in Baltimore, you as a black artist in DC, how do we continue to contribute, and not only contribute, convey to the upper class, with all due respect, the upper class, how do we convey that we as artists are putting our bodies on the line by being on stage and making this crazy ass music?
Past plus present equals future. So what you have displayed today in the panel, we are learning the historical analysis. I applied this conference initially on my own abstract. It was, I'm not a major selection, but we still concluded another way of getting to this conference to discuss these matters. We need to take into consideration and really look at the cause and effect and the source of what we're dealing with, such as you said, a system that's been put in place. Because there are many warriors out here right now in the arts and entertainment, in the black arts and entertainment community, in the black avant-garde Islam, or black jazz Islam, black American music study, that are out here conveying the message, or the message of music it was called in the past, and are fighting this revolution or this agenda to deal with Black Lives Matter and that sort, to reach the upper middle class, to convey to them, you're dealing with a double-edged sword because remember they had a hand, you want to bite the hand that feeds you. And they're the ones that are dealing with supplying the source of income for a lot of revenue, which we can see and trace back historically. Even when we look at analytically as a one who's teaching jazz and history, I understand how jazz is being exploited from the beginning of being a social music entwined within the community, going back to the plantation, from the transatlantic Holocaust, coming out of the various systemic systems and language we had out of the continent of Afro-Yakar, also known as Africa, misnomer as Africa, meaning land of separation and divide in the early term. So when we're dealing with that concept, we have to understand now that in fighting music, there are many people there in music, you just have to keep pushing, you have to lead by example first, and only really should be surrounding yourself with like-minded beings that are moving this movement, because this is not for everybody. We need to ask the major entertainers that we have today that are in a powerful position right now, that are out here taking the, what quote unquote, sellout route. I'm talking about bitches, hoes, and weed, and dope.
Sure.
And things of that sort, or the misogynation. We don't have to go into details. And attack them. And then we also need to look at those who are even allying or standing with Black Lives Matter, such as brother was in the Winter Jazz Conference. And there are many people right now who are cliche Afrocentric or Eurocentric or whatever you want to call it, or solidifying saying that they're with Black Lives Matter, but it's really only a trend. Because we have to look at the fact how even what we just discussed in the 60s with the black avant-garde that became a trend.
I agree.
To wear dashikis and afros and bones in ears and talk about Uhuru black power, and really was dealing with many other agendas totally not related to the black coming together or the black unification of the black community and things of the sort. I don't need to give you the details that create a serious debate here. We're not here to debate today. We're here to unify. We can debate all day long, but what they mean, we need to come to a common conclusion moving forth. So, me and you discuss this all the time. Yes, I'm a product of Baltimore City, West Baltimore and East Baltimore. And the murders and choices with Freddie Gray and the things going on down there, and every major black entity that we talked about, with all the killings and murders and the homicides take place every minute, every day we're talking about. So my question would be to the audience in here, or mostly non-African American, what are you doing? Even though you're here in the audience to observe and entertain and hear and want to discuss about Black Lives Matter, but when you leave out here today to understand the position that you have and being a non-African American, the privilege you have, being here in Boston, the center of the creation universe of American KKK, an educational system, Harvard University, built by African American slaves, this whole land here, what are you doing the minute you walk out this door to go enjoy your warm Starbucks coffee? And to know that you have a privilege to not be harassed by Cambridge police moving up there. I lived in Boston for 10 years. And then I broke through this area 10 years, and I was harassed in this area multiple times. While I'm going to Brickhouse Music, lived in the Roxbury, go jazz, band, and finally ending in Cambridge before moving to pursue my master's degree. So we must understand, what are we doing now that we are here to address the situation? Because there has to be a movement in the mental. And to know what position you, what side of the corner, the fence, where you play. Because we can sit and talk about Black Lives Matter all day, and I hold solidarity and care about a black person. But what are you doing to help? Well, that's not my problem. I live in Newton. I live in Wakefield. I have my car, and I don't have to deal with black people today. I may work with them. I like them. But I don't have to work with them today. So this is just typical stereotypical things that we deal with. And it's not to attack anyone, but to understand how you're dealing with a situation. Oh, it's sad. It's on TV to get murdered today. Well, that's nice, but look, I don't live in that family. So again, to answer your question, is like-minded individualism, moving those or moving in the same direction, not worrying about the distractions. As I mentioned to the person in the back that asked earlier about the European conquest and things of how to deal with that multiculturalism connection. And when you move like-minded individuals, that becomes strong. And only deal with that in that aspect to be able to get the message and consequently. We cannot have music without social political struggle. Music is based upon social politics. I teach that all the time in my class. No form of music in here does not exist without social political struggle. Even if you think about death metal and the whole satanic aspect comes along with a quote unquote stereotype, they're still resisting sub pop white culture, resisting to some form of not having what they want to have. So, in that aspect, Black Lives Matter movement, deal with historical analysis, but you got to understand the past. Because if you don't understand the past, you cannot move forward. And resolution. We talk about the problem, but we need to move towards resolution. And towards moving resolution, work with like-minded individuals to begin to move forward with domestic music contemporaries and artists who are in writing, and to address and call people what we call on their stuff, for lack of better terms. And address them. Thank you.
Thank you.